Rick. I'm ready, Dan.
Impatient JJ. Welcome back, listeners, to The Brighter Side of Blue, live from the Blue Line Technology Studio, our first sponsor. I'm Danny.
I'm Tommy.
I'm Jim.
Jim.
He's still Jim.
Feel a little zen. Feel a little zen, okay?
Okay. Oh. You never know what our little buddy over there is going to be or who he's going to be. Okay, Jim. Okay, Jim. Welcome aboard, Jim.
I'll never say that again.
Who's this Jim character?
Sorry about that.
Next week he's going to be Charles Nelson Riley.
Oh, my God. Caught me off guard. Tommy, 351 cities.
Yep.
We just filmed our first video, YouTube video of The Brighter Side of Blue.
The podcast. That was fun. Yeah.
It was unbelievable. We're in 9 countries still. We're on all the continents, but we're missing Asia.
Yep.
We can't ring in Asia yet. It's early. I
think there's a could be a language barrier.
No.
Hey, I had a friend of mine that lived in Asia, or he played soccer with me in Quincy. I'll reach out to him.
Is he still in Asia?
No, here, but he's got family there. He's got family there. Tell him to call his family.
And just listen to the podcast.
Right. Just download it once. Ain't going to listen to it.
Just download it once.
Call down to Harold's Chop Suey. They can send the word.
That's probably a better idea.
Take a listen. Yeah, we're missing Asia as our continent.
Let's call people. Have them click on stuff. Yeah, download stuff.
If know someone in Asia, would you please call them and tell them?
Just tell them download an episode so we can get another continent.
JJ, how can they get merch over in Asia once we get
rolling? I have no idea about Asia.
No, is it made over there?
They're not listening.
They probably get it before we do.
It'd take a long time to get it there.
Take a right.
Just tell them to make it and keep it.
That's wrong.
You want me to say how you...
Yeah, tell our listeners how they can get some merch, dude.
Well, you get on any of our social media pages, and the little logo that has our little badge with the microphone in it. If you scroll down, there's a little word that says "more," and it's darker than the rest of the word. And you click on it, it'll open up our merch page, and you just click on it, and then you can order.
On the description of our podcast.
Description,
you know. So when we describe, like in this particular episode, what Jerry Leyshock's going to talk about.
You want to do this?
No, but you forgot. You were confusing people.
No, you're right. It's okay. I thought I was clear.
No, you're clear. I was just adding.
Two things you can support us.
A little bit.
Like and share us our shorts or podcasts or videos will help us. Maybe we'll get to Asia. And then 3, subscribe on YouTube. And if there's a little bell, right, Tommy?
Yep.
You click that bell and you'll be subscribed to it.
Yep. And then you get notifications.
You get notifications.
Shit.
Great. And then you can also, number 4, tell your friends and have them share it. And then number 5, repeat the first 4 things that I said.
Yep. I think you need to repeat that every episode. That was a perfect description.
I will.
You did good.
So it'll be different every episode, but I will do the first.
Now, Tommy, I have a question. He just read out how we can do it, but are we still allowed on
TikTok? We got our first community guidelines ban on one of our shorts.
What'd we do?
That was... And if you took a poll of our listeners and said who would probably tell the story that would get us banned off of TikTok, not banned, but one video taken off, and you said which one of the co-hosts here would tell that story, producer John would have definitely came in last place. But his story about Jimmy the short person got us kicked off of TikTok for a community guideline violation. No, we're right back on.
Oh, good.
It was just that particular video.
Oh, okay.
Is this going to be on TikTok, this segment here?
No.
Jimmy the Midget.
Okay, see. Now, Tommy.
Come on now.
That outburst from producer John is the exact reason.
Right.
The exact reason we had to go and hire an executive producer.
Yep.
Producer John has a boss.
I think he just turned you off.
He's got some anger.
He turned me off.
Thank you for tuning in to Producer John's show. I'm turning everybody else off.
Yeah, next week's show we'll introduce our executive producer.
Yep, Jack Milken, part of our family, and he's part of the police family. So
exactly. Well,
now he's John's boss.
He's John's boss.
I love the game.
This should all stop.
He'll be a good boss, John. It'll be good for you.
No, but from this point forward, we're just going to go with Short Jimmy. So we will no longer refer to him as, like John did just a little bit ago, very angrily, as very Jimmy angry. The Midget. But
that's what he went by.
We're going to go.
He calls himself Jimmy the Mark.
Times have changed.
Times have changed, JJ. We're getting with the we're getting in
Jimmy tune. Hasn't changed. He's still short.
Right. So that's why we'll call you Tall Jimmy.
Tall Jimmy.
Hey.
Or Jim. Yeah. Tall Jim. Please.
Hey, Tall Jim. I'm Jim.
I didn't. I made a mistake on that one. Yeah.
No, you're all right. But that leads right. me into my next thing, which because you kind of turned this yourself around a little bit. You brought out this Jim JJ Zen moment thing, yep. and it's really caught fire.
Backed by popular demand.
It's very much backed by popular demand. But it's
how long is this going to last, though?
Every week.
It gives people peace. You're helping people. All right. With good, JJ Zen.
There are good. No parameters on Zen.
Right. Okay.
You got thoughts, dude. We need to hear them.
Yeah, but before it, I mean, I think now's a good time. It's meant a lot to me, the right. Zen moment. Yep.
It's worked so well that John, producer John, has given the JJ Zen moment some music. So hit the music, Johnny.
JJ. All right, well, this one comes from Jimmy Long. He and I went to Webster University together, and he...
Wait a second. Jimmy Long is the opposite of Jimmy the Midget.
Yes, Jimmy Long is my old partner in mobile, and now he's a DE agent. And I actually called him today because he always had this saying. I couldn't remember it exactly. And he said that we got it from one of our teachers at Webster University. I believe you guys attended that school, right?
You went to school?
Yeah, unbelievably so, yes.
You went to school?
You went to school? Oh, my God. What? School?
Can I do my Zen moment here?
Sorry.
Yeah. This is what the teacher said, and I do like this. And Jimmy read it off. He remembered it from the top of his head, just bam. Here it goes. Do more of what works, do less of what doesn't, and try new things. Let me repeat that again.
Is
that
yes, please.
Yeah. Please.
I wasn't listening.
Do more of what works, do less of what doesn't, okay. and try new things.
I dig it. I dig it.
I dig it. I dig it. I'm only going to give it
a... I think Leyshock would like that.
I'm only going to give it a 6.2.
Leyshock would like that.
I'm only going to give it a 6.2.
All
right,
well.
You need to get better.
Yeah, you can do better. Focus.
I got like another it. One. Want to do another one?
No.
You only get one shot. You only get one every week, baby.
Jimmy Long liked it. He thought it was a good idea.
No, it's because he wrote it or found it.
He didn't write it.
He found it.
All right.
Hey, your Zen moments are important to me because...
It's a failure. We can just stop the whole Zen thing.
No.
Never stop. Here he goes with the quitting thing. The whole quitting. Hey, hang in.
A lot of pressure coming up with it. Saying, you guys just ripped the shit out of that one.
Hang in there, Jim.
Tall Jim.
Hang in there, Tall Jim.
Jim the tall guy.
He just maxed and made fun of his long neck.
No, a lot of people do. And
I didn't even notice it until you said it.
It hurts.
Sorry.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Hey, the Zen moments caused me to reflect myself. And when we were talking about family, which you're going to take our family story here.
Family of the week.
Family of the week. Yeah. But before we go to the family of the week, I owe last week's family of the week a little apology to Tony Locknick because thinking about JJ's Zen moments made me realize that I said something that was totally inappropriate for us in blue. When I was talking about Tony, I said, hey, we ought to take his badge. Hey, we don't take policemen's badges. We've buried brothers in their badges. We will be buried with our badges. That's something we don't take lightly, and we don't joke about. So I apologize to Tony about that. He's a phenomenal policeman. He can be a jerk sometimes. I'm not going to. So I apologize for it. It'll never happen again. And it all came to me after listening to your Zen moment.
That's nice that you did that.
Yeah, thanks. Well, it's true. We don't do that.
Unfortunately,
we've all buried friends and family with their badges, and so it's not something we make light of ever.
So you did mention the family of the week. So we're going to have a family of the week in every week. So this week we are going to stay on the same family. I knew it, but I didn't add them last week. Is the Malacheks are related to the Lockenecks. Many of you have heard from Tom Malachek. I think he was in episode 2 when he talked about the governor's plane going down. Great story. And he's a good friend of ours, and Tom is a cousin of the Lockenecks, and they're married into the family, and Tom's father married into the family Tom Malachek Sr., who was also a policeman. So we're going to have to add them to the Lokenik family. Tom Sr. did 30 years, retired as a lieutenant, many, many prestigious assignments along the way, as you can imagine. I think he ended in juvenile, if I'm not mistaken. Then went on to be the director of security for Brown Shoe. And while he was there, he also held the position with the NFL while the Rams were in town, and he worked for the NFL as in their security department here in St. Louis. And then we all know Tom Jr. We've heard many stories about him. We do want you to email us if you have a family of more than three. We're going to have to cut it off somewhere. So if you have a family and if family in law enforcement of three or more, love to hear from you. And we will acknowledge your family, and we look forward to it.
Yep. Didn't you say we were all one big family?
We are.
Then we should be the family of the week.
We're always the family of the week. All of That's us. An assumed Every family of the week.
Where's that song? We are family. There you go.
That's
JJ Zen.
Oh.
All right, moving on.
I'm excited about this week's show. We have the last in our Legend series, number four. Yeah, chapter one of the Legend series yes. is closing at number four with Lieutenant Colonel Jerry Leyshock, who is a dear friend of mine and my family's and a mentor of mine. And he's come on, and what a great show.
Well, and it was a pleasure having Jerry on, and it was great stories. And Jerry's a very big follower of us now and has suggestions for shows that we're going to use. And one of the things about the whole Legend series that we've put on is those guys from Joe Spies Sr., Joe Burgoon, Harry Hager, and Jerry Leyshock have meant and changed the careers of many, many people. I didn't have the pleasure of working with any of them as far as, in unfortunately.
Right.
But you hear the stories, and I knew they were legends from the just growing up in the police department. You hear those names all the time. Well, what's really and then when we were coming up with the idea of this podcast is that we were talking about what can we talk about, who can we get on, and all three of you guys were just we got to get Jerry Leyshock on, and it's because you guys have all worked with Jerry, worked for Jerry, and moved up the police department with Jerry, and he's meant a lot to you guys. So I would like to just go, and let's just start with you, JJ. Tell us a little bit about Jerry and what he's meant to you.
Well, Jerry is probably the most well-known policeman in my ear. Every person on the street would call him Leyshock. And I learned so much from him just from, he actually got put out of narcotics, or we don't want to get down that path, but when I first got out, and he was just making arrests, and he was just, everybody was scared of Leyshock, because he was just on the streets, and he was sneaking in houses, and I learned that he wasn't doing that,
that was the myth. He wasn't sneaking in houses just on them, right?
No, he was sneaking in houses and doing surveillance.
Vacant houses.
Yeah, okay. I'm sorry. I should have been a little clearer. That's kind of important. But he was going vacant houses and he watched dope sets. And Danny's going to tell a story later about him. To me, though, he was like everything. And I got to know him through softball. He asked me to play softball. And Danny and I, we played basketball in the Police Olympics with him. He ran the team for 1 year, and Danny and I figured out that the basketball court didn't have enough balls for either of us because we both never saw a shot we didn't like.
Yeah,
but I was always open.
He was, and he always had a clean shot. I mean, I thought I was a ball hawk. Holy crap! But anyway, let's move on.
I was a better shooter.
He was a good shooter. Danny was a good shooter. But Jerry, I got to know him really well working for him at the Busch Stadium, and just a great guy. And he's always interested in what you have to say. But early before that, I was in SWAT, and we get to work out in SWAT, and we go to the gym twice a week before we start our shift, and he was always in the gym. So I'm working out. He's got done working out. I'm walking towards the track, and he was like a captain at the time. And so he says, "Hey, Jim, you mind if I run with you?" I'm like, "Tell a captain, no, I don't want to run with me." So I'm like, "Yeah, come on." So he's just a good guy. So we ran, and then went up there and ran. I think we probably, I always did 3 miles, and Jerry can just run like nobody's business. Mm-hmm. So we ran, and we had a conversation the entire time. And he was just interested in everything I had to say and just a great conversationalist. And I got done. I'm thinking, you know what? How many people in general, much less a captain. He was a captain. Everybody else was watching me like, wow, JJ's running around with the captain. And a legendary captain for me and for most. And I said, you know what, Captain, you're the one few people in this world that you ask a question. Most people of rank, of any rank, they're not really interested in what we have to say. But when you ask a question, you are actually interested in what we have to say. And that is a trait of his. When he asks you a question, you know him. And John, you know what? When he asks you something, he really wants to know what you have to say. And that's a great quality, because most people, probably some of us, we don't want to hear other people what they have to say. We just want to tell our story. But he's actually interested in, he's one of the most interesting men there is. He should write a book. He's
I think you referred to him
as a Renaissance man.
Right.
Yep. I like
he is. He truly is. So anyway, and I don't need to kiss up to him now. He's not even. He's my DraftKings golf partner, and we're friends. I talk to him every week. But he's a good man. He's got great stories.
Meant a lot to you.
He does. He's a good, he really is an interesting person. So,
Danny, you got a funny one for us. What do you got?
Well, yeah, I do have so many funny stories, because Colonel Leyshock and I were actually partners for a while. When he came out of narcotics, we rode together in the 8th District, and he's always been a mentor, an unbelievable friend. He's a friend of my entire family. My mother, my deceased father, everybody knew Jerry very well. My whole family knows him very well. He is a man of ethical standards beyond compare. I mean, unbelievable.
Which made it hard for you to be involved
with him. Well, no. Well, he taught me. I couldn't. He kept me straight. I mean, seriously.
Just kidding, brother.
He kept me straight. He taught me everything I know about policing. A couple things about him I can't help but mention. Number one, we mentioned it earlier in the show. He's a terrible driver. The worst driver.
That's mentioned in episode 3, dumpsters.
Never met a dumpster he didn't want to hit with a car, and then didn't want to report it. He was a terrible driver. But he was a genius, and really quickly after he came out riding with him, we went in plain clothes to do drug investigations, and there was a dope set on Paige and Sarah up in the 8th District, and they were selling buttons of heroin. And, you know, before Jerry came along, I was always watching this dope set, wishing that I could catch these guys dirty with the dope, and I could never, ever. I'd stop them a million times, see them gathering and doing their thing, but I could never find the dope.
Doing, right?
I knew what they were doing, and they all had the records to back it up.
Right.
But I could never catch him. So Jerry comes on board, and I say, hey, there's a dope set at Sarah and Paige. I can't conquer it. I don't know what, whatever. And Jerry says, well, you know, you work 7 to 3? Yeah. He goes, well, they get out there at 5:30, 6 in the morning. So if you think you're going to come to work at 7 and catch the dope man, you're not. He said, so we meet me at 5 a.m. We go into a vacant, destroyed building across the street from the dope set. We get up there with binoculars, and there's nobody on the dope set yet. It's still too early. And then all of a sudden, they start showing up, and I'll be damned, about, 6:30, 6:45 in the morning, this guy goes over about 100 yards away from the corner, and he lifts up a rock, couple rocks, and he stashes something underneath there. Obviously, it's the heroin.
Stash.
It's the stash. And then comes back about 100 yards. He's on the corner, and they're all out there. So we climb back out of the vacant building. We get in our unmarked car, and we drive around for a while, and then we pull up, and Jerry tells me, Danny, you go engage the guys and start getting some names, even though we knew all their names. Just start talking to them. And he goes, I got this. So I go up there, and I knew them all by name. I was like, what are you guys doing? Blah, blah, blah. And Jerry comes up behind me, and he's got this long twig. It's like a long branch.
Like a V-shaped vein?
Like a weather vane. And he's...
You got a hand on each end?
He's got a hand on both, and it's a long branch.
Right.
And I didn't even know what he's doing. Okay? and he's... Jerry's... I'm with like 6 guys, all with narcotics records.
They all know Leyshock.
They all know Leyshock. And Jerry's just over to the left, and he's just walking around with this weather vane stick, and he's just going around, and...
searching?
It's like a divining rod.
Divine. That's it. We kept calling it a weather vane.
I screwed that up. Yeah.
And I followed after JJ and went with the weather vane.
You went right with it.
I knew what you were talking about, too.
I know, but I shouldn't.
Producer John just nailed it again.
That's why you're producer.
That's why the producer John. He just nails shit.
You saved the whole story. JJ was a weather vane. People are like, I'm on top of a roof spinning around like northwest.
You jumped right on. I was just setting you up. I did it on purpose.
Jesus. Thanks, John.
Go ahead.
Thanks.
I learned that at Webster University.
School?
All right. So what's it called?
It's called a
divining rod.
Divining rod.
I would never. I forgot
that. But he's now. So now the listeners know.
Right. So he's walking around, hand on each end.
Hand on each end, or walking around, and these guys are starting. They're not looking at me now. They're looking at Jerry, and they're
Leyshock.
Like, they're like, Howard, what's he doing? And I look over, and Jerry told me the word. I go, well, you don't know. They go, no, what's he doing? What's wrong with Leyshock? I go, that's the dope stick. And they go, dope stick? I go, yeah. I go, don't worry about it. I go, you guys told me they're not doing anything around here. There's nothing
ain't no dope around here. No big deal.
Around, don't worry about it. I go, but he'll just go on this little hunt with that dope stick. If there's dope around here, it's going to lead him right to it. They're like, get the hell out of here. I go, I know. No, we have nothing to worry about, guys. You don't have any dope out here. Jerry walks right over to those stones, that divining rod leading him right there. He says, Danny, I think I got something. I think I got something. It showed me something. I go, guys, stay here. Nobody leave. Jerry lifts up the rocks, and there's a couple things. There's about 60 buttons of heroin.
Nobody ran?
Nobody ran because they were in a stall.
They were in
stall.
They were in awe of the divining rod?
They were in shock.
The dope rod. Dope stick.
And first of all, we knew exactly who put it there, so we knew who we were going to arrest because we watched them. But that's a secret. But they go, oh, hell no. Leyshock. Dope stick.
Leyshock.
He free-cased him.
No, he didn't. But
that's
let me tell you something.
Saying, I guarantee that's what they said.
That's what they told their friends.
So we locked the guy up to put the 60 buttons there. But let me tell you something. Over the next 3 years or so that I rode with Jerry, every dope set we went to, they knew about the dope stick. And the old wise old heads would say, don't let Leyshock pick up that dope stick. You're going to jail.
My Jerry story goes back to late 2001. I had just gotten transferred out of intelligence as a sergeant. And Joe Moquin put me in internal affairs. I didn't really want to go, but it was a good landing spot. And the deputy commander was none other than Dan Howard. So we had a great time, but I really missed being on the street. And I was always, you know, threatening Dan to get out of there. And he said, to stay here, stay with me. So one day Jerry Leyshock walked in the office. And so I was in Dan's office. I said, what's Jerry doing up here? And he said, well, he's starting this new housing authority unit. He's going to ask Ryan Clyer, who's a legendary sergeant on his own. And we're trying to get Ryan on the show sometime soon. But he's going to offer Ryan the job as a sergeant in the new unit. So Ron turned it down. He was getting ready to retire. He didn't want to, have to, get involved in that. So Jerry did come to me and ask me for the, if I want the job. So I said yes, and Dan got pissed off because I was leaving him. And, but it was nothing personal, Dan, but,
No offense taken, John.
But it was a good thing. We started this unit. We recruited officers to go down there, and it was just fun working with Jerry on that. He gave us free rein to do what we thought was going to work, and it did work. And I was just grateful for it. And I spent 5 years in housing with Jerry.
And you guys talk about that in the clips that are coming up. That it was special to Jerry, and it was special to you guys, and it was neat.
It was a neat
thing that you guys actually started. Got rolling, and it still rolls today. And JJ, you were a commander in the housing unit too.
Yes,
right?
I was. Yep. Left there only because the mobile spot opened. So
it was a fun unit.
Well, I think it's time to go ahead and listen to our last legend of this series, number 4, Colonel Leyshock.
Can I interrupt real quick? On a personal note. Tuesday, the 30th, is the 20th anniversary of police officer Nick Sloan getting killed. Nick's dad, Terry, was one of my mentors. He's one of my sergeants. I'm very close with the Sloan family. And I knew Nick since he was a little boy in grade school, and it was just a really sad time. And you know, just our thoughts are out to the Sloan family. I talked to Nick's mom, Chris, yesterday, and she's holding up pretty well, considering Terry died almost 6 years ago. So it's been a rough run, but she's a really tough lady, and it's a tough family. And I just wanted to recognize Nick.
Yeah, doing a good job. And unfortunately, guys, well said, we're getting some texts just came in. You guys are on the text thread, too. I had a chance to read them while you guys were talking. Johnny Burke, who is a retired lieutenant from the police department, legend in his own self, just needs some prayers. He's battling. He's up against it. And he needs some prayers. We had the honor of interviewing Johnny a week ago, and we're going to get that to you guys. Johnny talks about his career, and we're going to get that out to you in a special episode. But
he's a warrior legend, and he's up against
it.
So
he's a tough dude.
Prayers out to him and his family.
Absolutely. And with that, and then it's kind of fitting that you know, with the Sloan dedication that you did, John, and unfortunately with Johnny Burke, but they were both very close to Jerry too. So
yeah, true that.
But sorry to lead into the legend or to the Jerry stories, but you're going to really enjoy these, and we'll see you guys next week. Peace. Actually, we will actually see you next week because it's video recorded.
Yeah, scary.
Come on now.
There you go.
Peace. All right, guys. Peace. What do you got to say about old Jerry Leyshock there, JJ?
I ran into his neighbor, Judge Stelzer, a couple weeks ago.
Is he okay?
Well, I didn't run into him. I saw him at the soccer game.
Okay,
thank you very much. I don't remember where I saw him, but I did see him. And we brought up Jerry's name, and he said that he called him a Renaissance man.
Renaissance man.
I like it.
And he said, and it's actually true. He says he one day they were at a family or some function in the neighborhood. There was a piano there, and Colonel Leyshock sat down and can play the piano like nobody's business. He's an accomplished pianist.
Yes.
He actually teaches inner city kids at 12th and Park on a regular basis, weekly. Teaches inner city kids. He also teaches chess. He's a mentor for young inner city kids on the chess, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Do you still volunteer at a food kitchen? Or at a...
No, I'm at Oasis International.
Oasis International. You can talk about that, too. And then, what else? I mean, he just does everything. And he's a cut man. He's been in major...
Pro cut man.
He's trained professional boxers. He's had them under his realm.
Missouri Boxing Hall of Fame.
Colonel, you took over a new unit. I think you probably named it, but the Housing Authority Unit.
Right.
And can you just tell us about that transition?
You know, that was interesting. That's something the police department worked on with the Housing Authority. And John knows, because he's one of the first sergeants in the unit, one of the first four sergeants in the unit. He's just a lieutenant. I was a lieutenant.
I'm on the sergeant. Mount Rushmore of the first sergeants in Housing Authority.
Well, good job. Exactly. But the police department became involved in discussions with Cheryl Lovell and Robert Batts, two of the neatest people, you know, we ever met. And just they wanted to help finance a unit that would only patrol public housing. And it was Bluemeyer, Cochran, LaSalle, Clint Peabody. And, you know, Jim Joyner knows. I mean, it was so violent in the Peabody and the Cochran, and plenty of violence in the Bluemeyer. And they had security officers, they had off-duty officers, but she wanted somebody. You couldn't. So part of the contract was, we couldn't get a detail. We didn't work BP fair. We couldn't get a detail. Couldn't leave the developments, but we may have a story about that a little later. But we were dedicated to the public housing. Those four.
Well, I'll just say one thing. When before you took over the housing, I was in Mobile Reserve, and when we'd have a long week, and our Friday was up, and they would say, hey, and Joe Spies would tell us, hey, you guys had a good week, go make an arrest, and we'll kick you out of here. So first in, first out. So we'd go hightail it to the Peabody's, and we'd have a car parked on, 14th, and we'd do a walkthrough, and then stir something up and get in a foot pursuit and catch somebody Well, we've had some really good arrests with crack. But then when Jerry took over, we were told that was off limits. He's got it. He don't want us messing with his housing area, that he has enough officers and he'll take care of it himself.
Damn right.
And that sucked because we couldn't go in there for first out arrest. So,
more fishing in a barrel.
We knew not to go in there, yep.
But, you know, Danny, we, John and I sat down, crunched numbers, looking at all the calls for shots fired, and especially in the Peabody and the shootings. And we knew we had our work cut out for us. I asked then Chief Joe Mokwa, I reached out to the Chicago Police Department, and we're better to talk to learn about policing in big time public housing venues than Chicago. And we took a trip up there.
And we took a road trip.
John Frank, Renee Kreisman, Kenny Newsom, and
Sean
Dace. Went up there, and it must have been 10 degrees out. And they have two big housing authority vans that we're going to go in. I think John and I were with the commander, Commander Brown.
Yeah, he was great.
What's that rank just above? Is above just above captain? It's actually a rank.
Yeah, commander. Yeah.
So he's a neat guy, and but what's interesting is, was it the Harold Ickey Homes? Did we? I think it was the Harold Ickey Homes we may have gone into, or
what's a Harold Ickey Home for our listeners? We have people listening in from London.
The same kind of housing.
We didn't go to Cabrini Green.
Clinton people.
No, I used to know all the names of those.
It's a development,
but high rise, and we drive
thousands and thousands of people.
So he is telling us, these guys, we used to have a heroin problem. He goes, we don't have any problems anymore like that. Not much since we took over. And he's a neat guy, but he's really touting his unit and all that. So as we go in there, I see a Mexican man and a Mexican woman in a little hot dog stand. It's like 10 degrees out. I mean, Chicago is so windy. It is freezing. And I mean, this place is teeming with people. And while he's telling me how they've got it on lockdown and all that, me and John are looking at each other. I probably saw 15 different heroin deals going down.
I think I saw a homicide while we were there.
We got it on lockdown, though. We're on lockdown.
Was it the guy that stole your truck?
I'd hate to see what it was before he took over.
Right.
But, John, if you remember, I think that I read everything I could on the broken windows theory. Right. I even called the guy that wrote a book about it and all that.
In New York.
I'm broke as a project window?
If you allow a window to be broken in 2 weeks, there'll be 10 windows broken. He goes, the same way with the crime. If you're not cracking down on the little things, then things are just going to spiral.
Right.
And so what we did, we recruited. And so I'd let John pick 4 or 5 guys. We had, where did we start? 20 officers? I can't remember, John.
Well, we started with one complex, and that was LaSalle.
LaSalle.
So I think we had like 8 officers to start with.
And do we end up with 20?
Yeah, then we got 20. I think we went to 20 when we went across the street to the Peabody. And then, we went from there.
Then we went from there to Cochran, then Blumeyer.
Yeah.
So LaSalle, that was a good way to start, just to get a feel for things. But then we went to Peabody. And, gosh darn, it was so wild. It was just so wild.
We would go up Shoto, and Jerry's like, don't go in, because we wanted to go into the Peabody's. We were,
this is right across the street.
Yeah, right. Because it was a couple blocks away, and there was a lot of traffic in between the two complexes. And we would go up Shoto, and every night we would drive by, and this kid would come out and look at us right in the eye and give us the finger. And he would just laugh and all that, and we would just keep driving, and we're all telling each other, it's like, all right,
one of these
just
days.
Wait, because we got a couple more weeks.
One of these days.
A couple more weeks, we're going to change this guy's style. So anyway, we go in LaSalle, we meet some of the, the people and I think everybody here that was in housing, 90% of the people who live in these complexes are great people. They're not there. The only reason they're there is because they don't have the money to live somewhere else. So it was a good relationship we had with most of the people who lived there, except for the ones who didn't want to,
abide
by the law. So So we finally get our extra officers and we decide just to do like we usually do. And I think Larry Plyman was with me, and we're just driving up Shodo, and the guy gives us a finger, and I'm like, yeah, whatever. But this time we stop, and we jump out. Well, he takes off running up the gangway, laughing. Well, he didn't know that there was like six police officers at the other end of the gangway, and he got locked up for trespassing.
Because he was trespassing. Things.
Yes. He didn't even live there, but...
well, that would be the trespassing, John.
We never saw him again after that.
We it sounds small, but you didn't want people that weren't residents out there selling dope, doing whatever they were doing. Even guys working on their cars. You don't want to see all this nonsense out there in the parking lot. Half of them didn't even live there. So we had to have a lot of meetings. And they grew more and more. And now and then some people would say, hey, you're harassing so-and-so. And we talk about our philosophy and what we were trying to do. And John and I personally were there for 5 years. Started at the beginning, there for 5 years. And at the end, we had the Christmas program. Hey, Danny, you don't even know this. I don't know who. I think it was you. I don't know. John, we had bicycle training. We gave some bikes away. We had a little obstacle course.
Yeah, for the kids.
Peabody Bicycle Club.
Yeah.
For the kids.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
Miss Clarice?
Yes.
We worked hand in hand with her.
Yeah. She'd been there for years.
Yeah.
And she put it all together, and we had.
And
we
she got was wary of us at first.
Yeah.
And
then I was just going to ask that.
Yeah.
So what I was thinking is that when you guys start this, and again, the feelings against the police are the feelings against the police. Mm-hmm. We all are aware of it. Did it take a while to where the people that started the program really engaged with you guys as this is working?
Yeah.
They had beautiful facilities there for kids. They built all these playgrounds and that. They were very, very nice. And there was when we first started, you go by the playground, there was 25-year-old guy sitting on the swings.
Yeah, no kids.
Right. And they were sitting there, just drinking beer and doing whatever. And after just a short time, a couple months, there was kids playing on the playgrounds. And that's when these ladies who lived there would stop us and say, this is the first time I've ever let my kids go out on the playground.
Wow.
And but I'm even talking about the executives of the housing authority. Well, and again, it's a plan at the beginning. And everybody doesn't know each other. But I think as it sounds to me, and you guys have all been in housing, but it sounds to me that there, when you start something, there could be some tension. And then you guys got right through that, and they were really acceptive of what you guys were doing.
Well, I'm so glad John talked about the playgrounds, because I invited Robert. Sharon didn't come down there a lot with us. She's busy, right, though. She was an attorney, hard-nosed woman, but, man, she was good. But I asked Robert, I said, why don't you come take, it's our first summer there. I go, come on down, take a look at what we're doing. And when we drove by the playgrounds and he saw kids, it was after school, or it was summertime, more people are out around 2 or 3 in the afternoon. He said, I can't believe what I'm looking at. Nobody out there slinging dope. We just, and it was a lot of give and take, but... And I loved the neighborhood meetings. I loved our, we did a big Turk, Demetrius Johnson came down. We had the best time 2-3 years before John and I left, giving the turkeys away on that Saturday morning, Saturday mornings before Thanksgiving. And just, it was one of the neatest assignments I ever had.
It was. And we've all had good jobs. And Jimmy, you were down there,
Yeah, Jim Joyner was in charge.
Robert Batts was there. When I first took over, he was at the end of his career. And he thought you and Sean Dace walked on water. Yeah. He was a really neat guy. He was a good dude.
A neat guy.
And he left. He was probably there a couple of months, and then someone else took over. But, yeah, you guys cleaned it up like nobody's business.
It was quick, and Brian Jost, who's one of the other, first guys who were down there, first officers, he and I went to a Blues game, and the third district was handling the Peabody's in LaSalle at the time before they changed district boundaries around, And these two coppers who rode that area, you know, we were talking to them, and they said, we're in the new housing unit. And this kid, young kid, cocky kid, said, the police officer said, you guys won't make it a week down there. They'll drive you out. He goes, they'll come, they'll shoot at you, they'll kill you, they'll burn your house down. And I'm like, I don't know of anybody in St. Louis, any criminals that are burning cops' houses down or anything. But we said, you're wrong. We're gonna get control of this place. And we went back and told that story the next day at roll call. And Colonel Page, we have to give him a shout out too. He just said, I don't ever want to hear you guys. I don't ever want to hear a story of you guys taking a step backwards. You're the police down there. You're put there for a reason. We have a contract with the housing authority. You go down there and you take control. And we did. And you know, we did it with just good old fashioned hard police work. But we never, if you warn somebody that, hey, we'd stop somebody and they live in another part of town and say, well, you can't be down here unless you live here or you're with somebody who lives here. And they're like, well, whatever. Well, next time we saw them, if they were standing out there, they got locked up. It was trespassing. And the circuit attorney's office did a great job of.
Yeah, we had meetings with them. And
yeah, and it was
Mike,
misdemeanor.
Mike Mullins, Judge Mullins. Well,
didn't Colonel Leyshock like to do the walkabout?
He'd always, make you get always a walk.
Jerry was always walking through there, and I'd see him. He wouldn't tell us, but it'd be 1 o'clock in the morning, and I'd see someone in a white shirt walking through the Peabody's at, you know, 1 o'clock in the morning. It'd just be Jerry by himself. Just walking, checking it out.
Oh, Leyshock. I loved everybody Leyshock. Down there.
If I knew who Leyshock was,
Tom, Father Nutt was on the police board. Grew up in public housing. He's
McNutt.
McNutt. I'm sorry, Father McNutt.
I was just laughing because he's laughing at that when you said his name.
I'm laughing just because I'm high.
No, I ain't making fun of you. I'm making.
Oh. No, it's me.
Yeah. Anyways, but he grew up in public housing, and he got Everett Page, who's one of the greatest human beings I ever met. He was my mentor when I was young. He's a lieutenant in the old 8th. The fairest man, tough guy. But they wanted to do this. Cheryl and Robert wanted to do it, and it just came together. All right, but we cannot talk housing. So John and I see 5 years. Our beloved sister Kim Haley became one of our sergeants. We had some transition, but we brought a very interesting character to our unit named Ron Martin.
Oh. Yes,
affectionately known as the Troop. The trooper.
I love trooper stories.
Oh, the troop. And he's doing great. He's in Northwoods. He's on TV.
He's a major.
He's a major, but he's also their chief spokesman.
He's in the co-op, North County co-op.
Well, what did I say?
Northwoods.
I'm sorry. Well, he was chief of police in Northwoods, and now he's in the co-op.
He's what you call a character.
He's a character. He is. Tremendous policeman.
Yes.
Yeah.
But keep in mind what I said, Tom, earlier. We were dedicated. So if you had Peabody, that's where I expected you to be for your shift. All right, but unfortunately, sometimes in the Cochrane, and especially the Bluemire, you didn't have to stray far. That some of our people from Cochrane and Bluemire selling dope a little outside, especially with all the heat we're putting on, and these guys would get away from the developments a little bit. So, Troop has. Finally, about the third time, John and I have to have a talk, and I said, "Hey, let me tell you something, because you had to kind of get right in front of him to get his attention."
He was kind of hard-headed.
I said, "I don't want to hear you anywhere other than what other development you're assigned to on that day. Don't lead the developments, sir. Yes, sir. You know, I'm always respectful." So, John, I think you tell it better than I do. What happened probably within 5 days? I don't know.
Well, an officer got hurt and had to be rushed to St. Louis University Hospital. And, when that happened, it's all hands on deck at first. But once the officer gets to the hospital, everybody goes back to what they were doing. But, you know, so anyway, well, Trooper was, you know, assisting, and you know, maybe he was blocking traffic somewhere or whatever till the officer got there. Well, it was like 2 hours later. And everybody's back to doing their job in the complexes. And we're up in Jerry's office, and we got the TV on, and they're talking, the news is covering this officer getting hurt. And then they showed a live picture from outside the hospital, and there's Trooper leaning against the wall, smoking a cigarette, and he's just, whatever. So So Jerry's like, get him on the phone. So we call Trooper, and he picks up right away, and Jerry goes.
On the news?
Well, he's
called. On the news talking to you.
Yeah, this is a private conversation. It wasn't on the actual news, but it was shortly after, and Jerry's like, oh, he's real calm. He's like, hey, Ron, where you at? And he goes, I'm up here at St. Louis U Hospital. And he goes, well, you're supposed to be in the complexes. And he goes, just by the way, why are you at the hospital? He goes, well, I'm up here getting a scoop. And Jerry goes, I'm the commander. I get the scoop. You get your ass back in the complexes right now.
We don't need you to get the scoop. Oh, John, your memory's terrible. That's exactly
Troop with the scoop, baby. Troop is getting the scoop.
And then Trooper calls me like on the way back. And he's like, do you think Jerry's mad at me? I'm like, yeah. He was screaming at you.
So when it finally, we could go no longer, we had to part ways. I brought him in the office. John's there to notify him that he's going to be transferred. And I had to pull out an old movie line. I don't know where it came from, Danny, but I said, Ron, this isn't personal. It's business. Godfather. But what district do you want to go to? Because you're done with us.
Yeah,
you know, though, he always respected the heck out of you, even when he.
Oh, he's a hard worker. And then when he went, maybe we made chest of him, just like we do all of us. But he's a hard worker.
Oh, when he went,
he's a great guy.
The Muni, he wanted Jerry there.
I went to. He was the first chief in quite a while at Northwoods to make some promotions. He asked me if I'd be the kind of like the guest speaker. I was so proud of him. Tremendous policeman, and we love him.
Yeah, he's a great friend.
Love him.
So. Where'd you get the scoop after he transferred?
Oh, my gosh.
Who gave you the scoop then?
That's why he brought Kim down.
Oh. Sergeant Kim Haley, good friend of the podcast.
That's right.
She'd get the scoop.
I'll say this, though. When he would do a search warrant, he'd have SWAT do it. And Steve Dodgers, the commander at the time, his search warrants were always point on, and he would always thank us. And he never, I don't think he ever had a bad search warrant.
No, you know, you're dead on. He was a good policeman. You're dead on.
And he was so, he always asked us, and he was so, you know, cooperative, and he always thanked us afterwards. And actually, Lieutenant Dodge or Chief Dodge always thought, oh, we do want troopers. This is going to be a good one.
And I have a soft spot in my heart for good policemen that are kind of knuckleheads.
Looking in a mirror, huh?
Yeah. But the other thing I wanted to get to is Jerry, we had Harry Hager on, and Harry is a legend,
yes.
As you know.
Yes.
And he brought up a case where you were involved with the Petties.
In my career, Sam Petty was probably one of the most prolific gangsters, maybe, if you want to use it. I don't know if Harry said, but he was on parole. He did an armed robbery where he shot an off-duty policeman in New York City. He was a bodyguard for H. Rap Brown from the Black Panthers. Sam and his family, there's different stories about this, but I think they kind of grew up around Pruitt, Iowa. Sam killed a guy when he was young, much older, and he was still a juvenile. I don't, not much happened with that case. He was highly feared. He was extraordinarily intelligent, but, you know, mean. And so I was undercover. Harry's memory's good. It was 1985. I was undercover. And it started off just, this whole investigation just started off as sort of innocuous. University City arrested a guy who had some dope on him, was a white guy. And he was telling them that he couldn't go back to prison. And I can't help you guys in University City. He goes, but I get my cocaine from a brother and sister in North St. Louis. So they called us. And Tony Wagner was my boss at the time and said, why don't you talk to this guy, see what he's talking about. So I did. And U City was, this was a somewhat of a low-level case, but this guy had a bad record. Got in the car with the guy, had some backup, drove up on North Taylor near Natural Bridge, and made a buy in the alley from a woman and her brother. I'm not going to mention their names. But they gave me their phone number and said, anytime we can go up to the letter. You know, I think my first buy was like $50 of Coke. Coke was starting to make a little bit of a comeback at that time.
Yep.
So, because heroin, there was a lot of heroin in 85. So, I didn't think that much of it. Figured out who they were. Neither one of them had a record. The brother had a nice job, but they had a little coke connection. Went there back, and this time just dealt with the young lady alone, not her brother. The third time, I ordered up, which is what we would try to do, see if maybe we could find who's their connect. And just a little bit, it wasn't much money, $100, $150. But they said, all right, we're going to, she tells me, we got to go get a guy, and then he'll get it for you. So I'm all right. I didn't think there was anything suspicious about it. Go up on Natural Bridge, meet a guy around her age, and we go up on Penrose, nice house, south side of the street. We're not far from Fairgrounds Park. And I give him the money. He goes inside. Now, while he's inside, I see guys coming out and putting in a car, the trunk's open, cartons of soda or what looks like soda, whatever. And when he comes back to the car, I did what we will always try to do when we're in narcotics. I said, hey, I'd love to meet this guy. He goes, he ain't going to meet no white boys. I didn't tell you that much right now. I go, I'll give you $100 if you're interested. He goes, he ain't going to meet no white guy. I'm going to tell you that right now. I go, all right. But I copped the address. I could see the address from where I was. And I just making small talk, I go, what's the deal with all the cartons of soda or whatever? You know, just playing it on. He goes, right. Oh, the family owns a market. And right there and then, I remember a conversation I had with a buddy I went to college. He was an insurance salesman. We used to read about the petty Hayman shootouts at the market at College of Carter and all that stuff. And I remembered, I hadn't been a policeman very long, and he called me. He goes, you'll never believe who I met today. I got an insurance policy with Sam Petty. Lives over by Fairgrounds Park. He goes, and he didn't tell me the address or anything. So, John, you know maybe better than anybody. They had files. It was so crude in the 80s, 70s, and the 80s. I go to intelligence. I pull up that address where they had these files in these drawers. And the name that comes up from that address is Deborah Randall. And I had heard of Deborah Randall. She used to date a gangster in the Pruitt Igoe named Merle Jr. Guy killed a lot of people, and then he got assassinated. And there had been some talk that she might have even done like a double murder in Atlanta. So I'm interested in that. So I wait till the next day because it's late at night and there's just some old guy smoking a cigarette in there to let me look in the files. And I don't remember who I talked to, but he said, you got money into what the address was? I said, yeah. He goes, that's Sam Petty's place. I goes, all right. I kind of thought, but Deborah, who's Deborah Randall? She's bad news too, you know? So did one more buy from there. And then, and guys, it was so crude in those days. We you know, your backup, the signal was if you're in trouble, if you're inside of a house and you're trying to make a buy, was throw something out the window or jump out the window or throw somebody out the window. You know, we didn't
do something. Couldn't take a chance.
The window seemed to
enter. I like the third option.
So I don't know, you know, we're not mic'd up or anything like that. And so the next buy goes good. Well, I order up because now when DEA heard this and the FBI heard this, we got a lot of federal partners with us, all right? So everybody is on this. Everybody tried to make Sam Petty and had a lot of luck. So to do the third, I order up like 2 ounces, which would be somewhat of a big deal. And DEA gave us some money. Well, I didn't like, they changed the meat place. And I told Tony, I said, man, I think they're going to rob me. I said, he's acting weird on the phone. By then, I'm talking to him. The girl just tagged along because I think she liked him. So they go, Jerry, we come as far as we're going to go with this anyhow. I had marked the bills from both purchases, so we know that's in there. I've ordered up. So my first search warrant was signed by Judge Anna Forder. First search warrant I ever typed up, Bob Tommy or Hef. There's another legend you guys should talk to, but legend. Help me type it up. Get the search warrant. When I show up, whatever the sign was, take your hat off if it's them, you know. And I do, and they swoop down on it. So there must be 50 people who's got that house surround. Because Sam, I mean, we used to read about these shootouts. Sam Petty was nasty. And there are a lot of people out there. So they had pretty much wanted to get those two people out of the mix. They took them straight downtown. And they were going to wait for Sam or Deborah or somebody to come out. They didn't want to do it hard. Plus, the big ornamental doors have been hard to knock in anyhow. So Petty comes out. They grab him. They say, come up here. And Tony Wagner had told me that night when I got to work, he goes, this is your last night undercover. He goes, this is going to blow up. He goes, so you're going to the street crew after this. Fine. So he said, come up here with the search warrant. So he's handcuffed. He is intimidating looking. Sam Petty is intimidating looking. So I show him that, and he goes, I don't care what you do. That ain't my house. I go, well, instead of us knocking in the door, why don't you just give me the keys? They seen you lock the door. He goes, I don't care. Go do what you want. I ain't got keys, nothing. I go, all right. So I get a sledgehammer, like I'm going to do it. You know, it's going to be somebody like Sal Sear or some big guy. But I grabbed his, and then he goes, all right. He goes, I don't live there, but I got a key. Whatever. We go in there. So inside we had 4 AKs, 2 Uzis, 2 or 3 pistols, a couple other rifles, and a shotgun. The 2 ounces that I ordered up were underneath the bed. And they found money at College and Carter, where Deborah Randall is. And found the rest of the buy money from the other purchases somewhere where he had money hidden. He had over 10,000 rounds of ammunition all around, all kinds of guerrilla warfare manuals, Morse Science Temple manuals, bulletproof vests. There must have been 10 bulletproof vests in there. Joe Burgoon eventually, I mean, we're there a long time. You know, this started, you know, maybe around 8 o'clock at night, still like 5 o'clock in the morning. Joe Burgoon had a search warrant. They came up, dug part of the basement up because they had word that he had caught the guy that burglarized his house and buried him in the basement. Yeah. That's how bad this guy was, but they didn't find any bodies. But anyways.
It was believable, though.
Yeah. Darn right. You know, this was absolutely a fascinating case, and Harry could tell it just as well because we used Harry in the pretrial hearing, the bond hearing, I should have said, the bond hearing. But the next day, the guy that lived on Natural Bridge, Tony Wagner, he would not talk to us. He said, they will kill me. They will kill my family. I sold dope to Leyshock. That's his name. You know, you're telling me. The girl just said, I did everything through this guy. And he wouldn't talk. Somehow, Tony Wagner kind of struck up a relationship with this guy's father. And he said, we're not going to charge him tonight because he's thinking maybe this is the kind of guy we're going to use as a witness. I don't know. Well, I mean, I don't probably go to bed till, I don't know, maybe 7 or 8 in the morning. And I'm not asleep an hour. And Tony Wagner calls me. He goes, get Tommy Clifford, get your partner, bring shotguns, get up to that house. We're going to take James Crawford to the bus station. He goes, somebody has already knocked on the door at this guy's house with some kind of a fake badge, asking that he wants to talk to him, said with the city police, you know. And the dad goes, he's not here. And he goes, when's he going to be back? And he goes, they're just driving around. And I guess what gave away besides the fake badge was I think they were in like a Pinto.
Who was James Crawford at
the guy that was sold dope?
Sold dope to him.
Okay.
All right. Did I mention that?
Yeah.
I'm trying not to mention his name. All right, it was James Crawford. I let it out.
Yeah.
Doesn't really matter because you could look it up. It's right. In there.
Yes. It's out on the internet. It's out on the internet.
You told me you might bring this up, so I kind of wanted to make sure but it was James. So he's hiding under the bed. So I had heard all these stories. Harry Hager's already told me. I think Sam lost the blasting caps to some dynamite. They were going to kill Joe Mocha, who's like the chief of police, but when he was a detective. All the people that they killed, nasty killings. I mean, you can make a movie out of this, but a sordid movie. Anyway, so we got him to the bus station. And as Harry said, there was a lot of stuff that linked. So Sam's on parole. He's got this terrible record anyhow. The feds are going to get him on these guns. Not so much the dope, but the guns. One of the guns was issued to his ex-wife who lived on Thekla, named Barbara Petty. When they tried to, so she's got to face the music and say, how did the gun in your name get over there? Trying to get that possession besides constructive possession, trying to just nail it down. So she effed off the sheriff or whoever served the subpoena. On the day that she was to testify in the federal grand jury, she walked out to a car and somebody shot her 11 times.
Yeah.
So, you know, everything, wow. Harry's already testified about how dangerous these people were. And one guy that really stepped up to the plate was an African-American. He lived in the 5900 block of Cote Brilliant, gun dealer, who testified that Sam and Deborah Randall came. Deborah had called him, but he didn't know until he saw Petty's picture in the newspaper who he was. He never said his name or anything. But he handled the gun. He asked all the questions about one of these AKs that was in there. And just showed how dangerous it was. Don Wolf, Doris Black, who used to do a lot of defense work for the Moore Science Temple, started off with the case, then went to Don Wolf. I don't know if any of you ever met him. Better guy. Didn't take any cheap shots on the stand with me. But really, my participation was, I mean, it's not like I ran into anything. Yeah, I bought some dope, and luckily the money, they didn't spend the money. So the money, you know, the buy money's in there. It's all pretty cut and dry. And I know there was some appeals. And then, as Harry says, he ordered up. He was moving heroin in. Harry says Tokyo, my recollection was it was Nepal, but he is right. They wouldn't release the dope. We never got him. In the monster conspiracy case with the Moore Science Temple, Sam was the only one that didn't get federally convicted on that.
Wow.
They couldn't link him enough to them for that RICO case. So Lorenzo Petty is still alive. He wrote a book. He's out. And oddly enough, he's on Facebook with one of his arch enemies, Dennis Heyman. I believe Heyman's a Christian now, but he's out. Pete Gober, who we know died a few years ago, told me that they got Lorenzo with a gun. They were waiting for him to come out of the house. He didn't go anywhere without a pistol. And when they came up, his window was down, and Pete was on with the gun. He said, put your hands on the steering wheel. And he goes, Jerry, I'm telling you, that guy, I could tell the way he's looking at me. He's trying to think if he could shoot me before I could shoot him. He goes, I never seen a colder stare. He goes, those guys were dangerous. Now, I've only been on, it's 1985. I came on at the end of 1979, so I barely have 5 years on. And they go, all right, go on in there and question Sam Petty. Okay. So I go in there, and I read him his rights, and I said, with all due respect, I got to ask you some questions. And he just looked at me, and he just leaned forward, and he goes, I don't have anything to say to you. And that was good.
That was good enough for
John,
you.
John, you know when you
good
know.
Good enough for you. Yeah, that's good enough for me.
Good job.
How'd that interview go?
Good job.
He's talking.
It was riveting.
You know what I've got out of all that? It's amazing. His very first search warrant.
Yeah,
I remember when
one.
I did my first
that
one.
That was your first
I got
search warrant?
Like
yeah,
eight buttons
yeah.
of heroin. His very first search warrant hit Sam Petty. That is unbelievable.
And a Porter's house.
Yeah. My first search warrant, I hit the wrong door.
But that's amazing. That his very first search warrant hits probably the biggest dope
that's
man.
A good
that's
one
unbelievable.
That year.
Yeah.
All right, so 2 years later. All right, so by the way, this is a fascinating trial. With all the security. I thought the bond hearing was one thing. With Harry talking of, Harry broke down four or five murders, including while they were trying to strangle a guy to death, last name of Cherry.
He told that story.
He did tell that story.
He told that story.
And, I mean, so, the Post, the Globe, covering this is a big deal. And then the trial. These young guys were coming in there. And they, because I'm there. They sit right behind me, just staring at me. So I'm getting—I don't know them. I'm getting good looks at all their faces, and I find out that one of them's Sam's nephew. I don't know in what way, Charles Shern. And then I start asking questions, and he's like, "This guy's moving a lot of dope. He's starting to make a mark for himself in the old 7th District."
Yep.
So 2 years later, me and Tom Clifford out there stumble on a little dope arrest. And the guy tells me about Charles Shern, and he's really moving a lot of dope. And and he's got a little idea of where the house was that he was going to, 4629 Kennerly. And then there's a murder at the Phoenix Lounge, right at Plymouth and Hamilton. So Homicide calls me later in that afternoon, just a guy, and they tell me the story that two guys rolled up on him, get out of a Cadillac, a stocky guy walks up to him, he's standing next to his girlfriend, put a gun right there, and he said, "You know how much you owe me?" And the guy, before the guy could answer, he blew his head off. They got back in and left. He goes, "We're hearing this could be a guy maybe named Fat Charles." And I go, "That's Charles Sharon." They go, "You know where you could find him?" And I said, "Well, he's supposed to be at 4629 Kennerly." I go, "Let me get back to you." So I parked my car somewhere, walked down the alley because he had a high wood fence, and there's that freaking Cadillac sitting back, green Cadillac sitting in the backyard. So they get the search warrant. That's the first time I met him. We get the murder weapon and a bag full of dirty, stinky clothes. You know, we get that, got some heroin and all that. They hold him without bond, I believe, because it's a good, the gal, you know, says that's him and all that. And then before it goes to trial, they call me and they said, "You're never going to believe this. She's completely recanted her story." I said, "Really?" They go, "He's going to be out. So we're just letting you know he's out. He's going to be out." All right. And his little henchman, he had a crew of about 7 or 8 guys. So it took me about 6 months. And then I found out the story that a guy named Daryl Shearn, Charles' older brother and another guy, got this. This gal lived in the neighborhood. Put her in the car, drove over to the Holdemont tracks. And they said, "Hey, you're going to either recant your story or we're going to kill you in the car. What do you want to do?" She goes, "Well, I don't even remember what happened." You know, that kind of, it's funny, but it's not so funny. Eventually, we get another guy, starts blabbing on him, and I watched this house, 6027 Suburban. I watched it for a month. And finally, I see Shearn and all of his people go in. There was like a movie, and they're looking around, and they go in, they go out. And I told Lee Mandamas that, and I was like, "We got to hit this house." And we hit it in 87 on St. Patrick's Day. And he had a big ball of black tar heroin right by where he was when we ran up there. People were flushing heroin and all kinds of stuff. It was just wild. More guns, more money, just this guy. They were rolling. And what ended up happening was that house and a couple other houses were issued in the name of Charles Taylor. And before we could get him to testify, they killed him. That was terrible. That really took the wind out of my sails. I really liked that guy. And, you know, it's just that legacy family, they were nasty.
Hit it, Huggy.
I'm checking my vital signs, drawing my battle lines, going to war again. Feeling the rhythm inside of my chest, all I need is just a pen. I know I was born for this. I know I was born for this. Don't care for the critics, my words are life, physics, a force that they can't stop. They just don't get it, I think they forget I'm not done till I'm on top. I know I was born for this. I know I was born for this. I believe we can write a story. I believe we can be an army. We are the warriors who learn to love the pain. We come from different places, but